పేదరిక అవినీతి రహిత భారత్ ను నిర్మించాలని ప్రణాళిక సంఘంతో నీతి ఆయోగ్ కు పోలిక లేదని రాష్ట్ర అభివృద్ధి కోసమే తాము పనిచేయడం జరుగుతుందని నీతి ఆయోగ్ ఉపాధ్యక్షుడు రాజీవ్ కుమార్ పేర్కొన్నారు. రాష్ట్ర అభివృద్ధి కోసమే తాము పనిచేయడం జరుగుతుంటుందని టీమిండియాగా పనిచేయాలన్నదే తమ ఉద్దేశ్యమన్నారు. దేశ సామాజిక ఆర్థిక అభివృద్ధి లక్ష్యంగా కృషి చేయడం జరుగుతుందన్నారు. ఏపీ రాజధానిలో జరుగుతున్న కలెక్టర్ల సదస్సులో పాల్గొన్న రాజీవ్ కుమార్ మాట్లాడారు.
That was led by kings and queens and feudal lords, as you remember. And after that, it sort of became a movement of the elite. You know, and for a very long time, it remained a movement of the elite. Even the Congress Party, where it was formed with Albert Octavio Hume and with Dadabhai Noroji, etc., remained a kind of an elitist activity for a very long time with its own meetings, etc., until the arrival of Mahatma Gandhi. And until the arrival, after the arrival of Mahatma Gandhi and his campaign all over India, when he went to all distinct parts of India, etc., culminating in 1942, when he said, quit India. He just simply saying, by saying quit India, by giving that call, he made an independence movement a mass movement. Every peasant, every Indian, every student, anybody, anywhere working in any part of the country, then joined that movement of saying that the British should leave India. You know, with this Lokman Tilak, Swadhinta, you know, Janam Siddh Adhikar, people like, Lajpat Rai and so on. Independence became a mass movement. And after it had become a mass movement, it took only a bare 5 years for us to defeat the biggest colonial power in the history of humankind and send them away from us. So it just took that 5 years. Which is what it seems we can do now. We achieved our independence in 1947. We have had 70 years of development. A lot of this development actually has been elitist in its nature. The dualism in our country has actually increased rather than decreased. It is us and them. It is the top 20% and the less 80%. India is marked by a very steep duality and a very steep dualism, and policy making also remained an elite activity in the confines of Lutyens' Delhi. We want to change that now. And we want to change that, and which is why the Prime Minister said that if in 2017 all of us resolve to make development, to make India's prosperity, to make India's, sort of growth, it's our own concern, each one's of our concern. If we make development our a mass movement, there is no reason that in the next 5 years, as we achieved independence after 1942 and 47, there is no reason that we will be stopped from making India great and making India, new India, developed India by 2022. And this is his call for Sankalp to Samriddhi, that if we do resolve to make this, then we can make a new India. So there is a historical precedent that when Indians get involved in doing something and when they resolve to do something, we have the ability, we have our inherent ability to achieve that in a short period of time. And that is why we think 2022 and New India is possible. And if we achieve that beginning of New India in 2022, ladies and gentlemen, there is no stopping us from becoming a Sarvashreshtha Bharat by 2047, where we will be counted among the first three countries of the world. We will be counted amongst them. And I think this is the call that Vivekananda gave, that India could become the Sarvashreshtha Bharat, India could become the Jagat Guru Bharat, etc. We could be a model for the rest of the countries to follow. So that's the background that I wanted to give to you. Next. But at the same time, we also must remember, we have to admire, we have to appreciate what we have been able to achieve in the last 70 years. I talked about India's dualistic development, I talked about policy being the elite. But you know, we are the only country in the world, we are the only country in the history of humankind which has taken the three transitions simultaneously. The social, political and economic. Every country else in the world has done it sequentially. You can see China, it is an amazing achievement that they have done in lifting 600 million people out of poverty in the last 30 years. But nonetheless, their political transition is yet not complete. Their economic transition has been completed, but that political transition is not complete. If you look at Europe, you know, they had a colonial power, they had their own, you know, they did not give their rights to the workers for democracy. America, you know, they did away with the native Indians, the red Indians. They then had the slavery for hundreds of years, for many, many decades, hundreds of years. They gave the right to their women to vote only in 1937 or something like that after the suffragette movement. Every country that you look at, in Japan, I mean, for the all country that I admire hugely and a country which is admirable, you know, after the Meiji Revolution in 1867, they just simply bumped off, they just simply did away with 3 million Christians who were there in the western coast of Honshu because they wanted a homogeneous society. We in India, our forefathers, our leaders, our national independent leaders decided that for this country, the size of the country, given the size, is plurality, is diversity, is continental nature, it's very disparate, you know, population and its divisions across caste and across communities, etc. We could not afford the luxury of doing one transition at a time. We would not have remained united. We would not have remained one nation state. And therefore they said, and this is what is entitled, this is what is enshrined in our constitution, that we have the social, the political, and the economic transitions going on simultaneously ever since. And look what we have achieved. The social transition is certainly complete. I come from UP, a largest state, a state 200 million people, probably with the sixth largest country in the world. We have had a Dalit lady being the chief minister on 4 occasions and completing her 5-year term without a bloodshed, without a drop being split anywhere. I mean, our political, that's our social transition, and that's an example of that, and you can find that example all over the country, you know, from the south, Tamil Nadu, to the north, everywhere. Our political transition is complete. Our federalism, which was only a beginning in the constitution, is now so deep and so entrenched that states are now talking about sub-national sovereignty. The states are talking about their own sovereignty, and the fact that NITI Aayog is now trying to work as a partner with all the states shows that our federalism has come a very long way, and our constitutional entities are safeguarded by all the things that we have achieved. Our economic transition is still in the making, and that's the one that I'm going to be focusing on. Our economic transition is not yet achieved because we have had to pay the cost of the other two transitions, but we have come from $150 per capita in 1947 to $1,800 per capita today. It's a huge achievement, but nonetheless, we still have 200 million people below the poverty line. We still have a lot of, I mean, the blemish of 38% of our children being born, you know, malnutrition and so on, affected by that. That economic transition, ladies and gentlemen, it is our duty, and you are the people who are going to do it. I am the person now in charge who has been given this great opportunity to complete that economic transition. And if we do it, believe you me, India will become an exemplar for the rest of the world, and that is what we need to achieve. Next. So, this is what the Prime Minister has in mind, and if we do this, and if we make development a mass movement, then what we will get by 2022, hopefully, is a Swachh, Swasth, Shikshit, Sampann, Saksham, and Surakshit Bharat. And that is what we should be aiming for. That is what we should be aiming for, and I think each one of them is achievable, and also that each one of this is interlinked with the other. If you don't get Swachh Bharat, you will never get Swasth Bharat. This is the final recognition that we know we have. That if we get Swachh Bharat, and if we get the hygiene, and if we get the social cleanliness, only then will we prevent diarrhea among our children and amongst our population, which is the basis for beginning to get a Swasth Bharat. So each one of this, if we don't get a Shikshit Bharat, we will never get a Swachh Bharat. You may construct all the millions of toilets that you may, but it is only the awareness and the education which will make the people use it. So all of these six attributes are interlinked. All of these can be achieved, and this is what should be our goal. And I'm sure a young state like Andhra, under the very dynamic leadership of our Chief Minister, will lead the way in each one of them. Next. And this is what the Prime Minister has said we should resolve. We should resolve that by 2022, we should have a poverty-free India. This is eminently achievable. We should have a squalor-free India, a Swachh Bharat. We should have a corruption-free India. And this, by the way, is the biggest game changer that you will have going forward. And I think we can achieve it. And this is what we have on our hand. A terrorism-free India, a casteism-free India, and a communalism-free India. These are the six pledges he wants us to have for making India a new India in 2022. And ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you that even if we achieve these six, and there are maybe others that you want to add to this, but if we have achieved these six resolve these resolutions, if we resolve in this, then I think we will have an India which will be unstoppable, and which will be unstoppable and which will climb to the top ranks of the global community within the next 5 to 10 years. And I think the time has come. I can feel it in my bones, as it were, that the time to make this transition has come. I'll just elaborate on each one of them for a few minutes each, and then we will come closer, close my presentation. Next. So on poverty-free India, I think this is what the Chief Minister was referring to earlier, the first point, Antyodaya. A topic which was called, you know, which was first mentioned by Deen Dayal Upadhyay ji in his writings, but really which was adopted by the World Bank as well when they talked about estimating the welfare level of the last decile of the population. If you measure the welfare level of the last 10% in each of your district, and that last percent can be easily identified, you can put them on a dashboard. You can do real-time monitoring of that last 10% of your households. And if you can see a change, an improvement in that last 10% of your household, the rest, I assure you, will be taken care of. This, by the way, also informs the recent initiative that we have launched in NITI Aayog under the guidance of our Prime Minister, which is the 115 aspirational districts in the country. We have selected on the basis of a parametric criteria 115, you know, sort of districts which have been left behind, and we've decided to call them aspirational district. If we can improve the level of living in those 115 districts, and those district magistrates, I must commend them because they were all in Delhi recently, if we can improve those districts, I think the nation, the country will look after itself afterwards. So that's the first one. The second one, of course, for a poverty-free India is that you need the rapid economic development, and we can bring globally leading firms. R&D, which is where we are lagging behind badly, our national spend on R&D is less than 1% of GDP. Korea's is 3.8%, and the Americans are 3.6, and the Japanese are somewhere there. I think, and out of that 1%, less than 1%, 80% comes from public sector. And our private firms only spend less than 0.2% of GDP. So I think we need to do that. We need to have, we are already having the largest startup economics ecosystem. We need to improve upon them. And we have to shift from startup to scale up. Because startup is easy in our country. Scaling up is what is becoming more and more difficult. And that is where I think you need to focus your attention as to why we in India are unable to create what are called the mid-sized firms. Some firms which employ between 220 to 200 people. We have firms, 98% of Indian firms employ less than 20 people. Only 5% employ more than 200 people. And we just don't have these firms in the middle, which should be the guts, which should be the real basis of our economic development. We, in Andhra, I hope we'll be able to create that. And we do want to reach, if we want to remove poverty, we must move from 142 to 100. We have moved already. And we should go within the next first top 50 in ease of doing business. And I was talking yesterday to the conference of electronic hardware manufacturers, MATE, and I was saying that if electronic hardware requires a special focus and treatment, which it should do in Andhra, then maybe we want to create an index of ease of doing business for electronic manufacturing. Because that might be different from that which is required for textiles and garments and leather, etc. Because that does require an ecosystem which is different. Electronic hardware manufacturing is very different, and I think we need to concentrate on an ease of doing business ranking ecosystem for them. Doubling the farmers' income, I told the Honorable Chief Minister that his figures were almost unbelievable, that he achieved a 14% rate of growth in agriculture in 1 year and followed it up by 25% in the next. I said, I must need to check your figures. And I asked him, who is supplying you these figures? And then he told me that this has happened because of the shift from primary agriculture to horticulture and floriculture, etc. Now that's the change we want to make. We want to shift from being traditional, from making our farmers simple commodity producers to producers of agro products, which have been graded, segregated, tested, and agro-processed. If we can connect our farmer to the agro-processing and then to the final consumer, there is no reason for me to believe that the farmers' incomes cannot be doubled in 5 years of time. Anybody who tells you otherwise, that on the basis of our last 20 years, where output has grown by 3.2% or agriculture growth is 4%, and therefore it will take 22 years to double your farmer's income, is simply not talking right. We can double our farmer's income if we make the transition from commodity agriculture to agro-product agriculture and modernize our agriculture, which we can do. The last one I'll leave out for a while, de-risking the farmers, but that is equally important. The farmers are vulnerable today. We need to de-risk him. The Pradhan Mantri's Fasal Bima Yojana is a step, but only the first step in that direction. We need to do much more by taking other steps. Next. For a poverty-free India, the next one is we need to look after that one top thing, and I just want to draw your attention, ladies and gentlemen, to just one thing. This is a blemish. This is a dhabba. This is a stain on our national record that we cannot afford to live with. 38.4% of our children born stunted or suffering from malnutrition, which leads to wasting, which means that their mental development cannot be the same as it should be, is below normal. How can we talk about a knowledge economy with that sort of a statistics? If you want to build a knowledge economy, the first thing that we have to do is to actually remove this malnutrition and achieve the Kuposhan Mukt Bharat by 2022. If we do nothing else by 2022 and only achieve this, I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, we would have done our country great pride and a great service. And I tell you, if Andhra can lead in this one particular indicator, and in NITI Aayog, we have already launched a nutrition strategy. The Prime Minister has made me the chairman of the National Nutrition Mission, which he announced some time ago and which we'll be talking about again next month, where all this, you know, several of my ministers are a member of that nutrition mission. We will be watching like a hawk on every state, on every district, how this nutrition mission is coming about. We are using the latest technology for this. We will have real-time data dashboard on this. And I am hoping, and I'm really hoping, that Andhra will lead this effort, because this is the effort which will be the bedrock of every achievement, any achievement that we want to make. The rest, actually, you know. You know, we can do, we have already launched in NITI Aayog, a school education quality index. We'll be ranking our districts and our states on that index with a random test every year or every 6 months, I forget, for classes from 2, 5, and 8. We'll be conducting those tests by outside agencies, and that is a preparation for re-entering PISA, the International Student Assessment Test, which we took part once 5 years or 7 years ago. We came last, with our Himachal and Maharashtra being Tamil Nadu being entered in that competition. India stood last in that. We want to improve that. Then the government decided that they don't want to take part in that test. That denial mode has to end. We have to go back to PISA, and we will enter that in 2021 as a result of what we are doing now. Beti Badao, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao is something that I think is dear to both the Prime Minister and the Honorable Chief Minister, and I don't want to mention anything more about that. Next. This is the infrastructure, something that my colleague, my friend Nitin Gadkari Saab is very fond of emphasizing. This is actually one of the key to a poverty reduction. People very often don't understand the link between infrastructure and poverty reduction. If you don't have roads in the villages, it's the poor which is stranded in the village and cannot come to the city. If you don't have roads in the villages, it's the poor, the small farmer that cannot send its product to the nearest mandi or to the nearest district. So I think it's quite evident that infrastructure has to be there, and some of the schemes that we have taken now, especially Udan and Sagarmala, and finally this Gram Panchayat with broadband, the fiberization of our economy, of our country, where hopefully one day very soon every village and every household, I was quite shocked yesterday to hear that pretty much every household in this state would get fiber and will therefore get for an amazing sum of 149 rupees, the recipient of all the channels and the telephony and all of the rest of it as messaging. I hope Andhra will achieve it tomorrow or the day after, and then the rest of the country will follow, because that's the future. That is the future, because if that future comes about, education and information will become free for every child in this country. And then you can imagine our amazing children, what they can achieve as a result of that. Next. These are the enablers. This is what we are going to focus on from Delhi, and we hope all the state capitals will follow, which is housing for all, the affordable housing, the energy, which is that every household must have energy, and I think we have done very well already in the last 3 years, and then financial inclusion. And financial inclusion, you can see that if